Nothing was peculiar, creepy, or out of the ordinary the morning that it happened beyond the ring. The light drizzle bounced against my windshield as I cruised steadily down the same highway I always did on my route home from work, a graveyard shift agreement with a diner far too out of the way for me to have found interest in, but I genuinely enjoyed the work, and jobs were difficult to come by in the village I'd spent my entire life rotting away in. My parents and friends often argued with me about how ridiculous the one-way hour drive was, weighing out the pros and the cons, and always determining that it just wasn't worth it, but I loved being in a new place with people who never recognized me unless I allowed them. It was around 3:15 a.m. when I saw it. A light blue Mazda with its hood up and a beautiful young lady beside it on the side of the road, just a few strides up the road from me. I made the quick decision to pull over considering the rain and the unfortunate hour. Need some help? Maybe a lift? I asked as soon as I stepped out into the rain. She was more beautiful up close and in person, in her own unique way. She wasn't a woman I would consider drop-dead gorgeous, and she fit no conventional standards of the word, but my heart skipped more beats than I'd like to admit, hoping she'd agree to a ride. She was reluctant at first and kept insisting that she was fine, and that where she was headed was much too far out of the way. But after some convincing and assurance that I had no problem taking her wherever she needed to be, I found her seated in my passenger seat, as I fumbled with the ignition through blushed cheeks. "Thank you for this," she smiled at me as I began to pull back out into the road. "There's no one else who loves me enough to help. I'm sure that can be true. Well, do you love me?" I felt her staring through me as I kept my eyes forward and was noticeably taken aback by the question. "Well, I mean, you seem great, but we've only just met," but I'm sure I was humiliated at the way I stumbled over my words, but who wouldn't? She let out a bellowing laugh and smirked at me, as my cherry red cheeks burned even more than they had been. "Well, that settles it. I'm sorry, your name?" "Matt." "Of course you don't love me, Matt. No one does." The comment, while concerning and dark, was stated with a still steady smile and a continued upbeat tone. If not for her demeanor, I would have become gravely uncomfortable. It was then that I realized I'd never even asked her where we were headed, and she read me the address of a gas station about 20 minutes in the opposite direction. "Are you sure that's where you want to go? I mean, there's a gas station right up the road from here. Or I could even find one closer to a mechanic. I know a really good one." She stopped me before I could finish. "If you don't mind the drive too much, I'd really like to go to this one. It's closer to home, and I'm sure someone might be more willing to pick me up there." It was an odd request, that left a lot of questions, all of which I was sure she either wouldn't answer, or would wave off given her absolute certainty of this specific station. "Why wouldn't you just have me drop you off at your house, then?" I wondered but chose not to ask. She wanted this gas station, I said I'd drive her wherever, so be it. We made small talk all the way there, which I was both thankful and anxious over. She made no more odd or uncomfortable comments, and said nothing that caused too much concern, but something about her drew me in, and I only wanted to know more about the stranger I was hauling back in the direction of where I'd left. "I'm sorry for making you uneasy earlier," she blurted suddenly. "I could tell you were uncomfortable. I've not been myself lately with the year I've had. You wouldn't believe it." Despite the embarrassment I felt as we drew our conversation back to my clear discomfort and humiliating fumbling, I jumped at the opportunity to learn more. "It's fine, really. Is the car not the worst of your troubles? If you don't mind me asking." "No, no, not at all. I guess that's why I've been so calm about it. Normally I'd throw a fit over such a minor inconvenience." She never stopped smiling. "I've come to realize that there's so much more to worry over. I mean, I hate to overshare, but I've just got to let it out." "Go on. I'm all ears." She sighed, and for the first time since I picked her up, she let her smile drop and leaned her head back as she stared out the passenger window. A moment of silence filled the car, and I'd wondered if she'd heard me wrong or didn't hear me at all. Just as I was about to repeat myself, she spoke, slowly and carefully, as if she wasn't sure she could trust me with such precious information. "I've made many mistakes in life. Too many to count. My biggest problem has been selling myself." She glanced over at me as she said it, trying to gauge my reaction. "Selling my entire self, I mean. Not just my body, but my heart. My soul. My mind. All of my love. I sold it all for a better life. It meant losing all sense of judgment. All morality, every last bit of goodness I had left." When she realized that my reaction would not change, she turned back towards the window and let her head drop against the glass. I decided to run away after my latest affair. He was lovely. Old, of course, but I really thought I'd found my soulmate. Someone I could finally surrender myself to, you know. That's what I thought, until he ended it. Was it bad? I questioned, making sure not to address the gigantic prostitute elephant in the room. She was delicate and needed someone, that much was evident, but I couldn't wrap my head around it. She was beautiful, well-spoken, and seemed intelligent enough. I would have never guessed it about her at first glance. I chewed myself out for assuming that anyone ever could. She let a smile return to her still-lit face, but her eyes looked glossed over. I didn't think she cried at all, but I was driving and never got a complete look at her. It was bad. He was married and I knew that. But something told me that I was different. I was a fool for thinking that. She chuckled to herself. Stupid. He told me that she'd gotten pregnant and I had to stay away from him. That everything we shared together was nothing, and that if I tried to contact him again, he'd get a restraining order. Silence fell over the space we shared for a moment, until she spoke again. It wasn't nothing to me. My heart ached for her. She was still a stranger to me, but I remember feeling like I should hold her, or at least reach for her hand. I didn't. The remainder of the ride was left with no conversation as I squirmed behind the wheel and itched for anything at all to say. Something told me that nothing I could conjure up would help her. We arrived at the station not long after that, and she quickly thanked me for the ride as she got out, shut the door behind her, and shuffled inside. I smacked myself in the head for being so awkward to someone in a vulnerable state, but to be fair to myself, I was never good at providing comfort. I left feeling humiliated and ashamed. The incident with the unnamed girl left me with a lot of unanswered questions and a bit of grief sprinkled with humiliation, but I tried to get it out of mind and go about my morning without thinking much of it. It was 6 o'clock that morning when I saw it on the news. Her face, her name, and a warrant for her arrest. Police are searching for murder suspect Ashley Marshall. She sat on my TV screen exactly as I'd remembered. Dark-haired with bright eyes and the familiar smile she'd sat displaying right beside me that morning. What could she have possibly done? Who could that girl, bright and bubbly and sweet, have hurt? I toyed with the idea of calling in a tip for a moment before remembering what she told me about her lover. That night I went to sleep telling myself that I owed it to Ashley to forget what I saw and pretend it never happened. Nobody could trace her back to me, right? Someone would find her eventually, and then she'd become someone else's problem. The attendant had seen her, maybe he'd call it in. I woke up the next morning feeling content with my decision, and made a vow with myself not to overthink it. The madness ate at me until the early afternoon, when I decided to go for a drive to clear my head. I'll go about my life as normal. I won't watch the news, and I won't think about where she is or what she's done or... Hi, Matt. The familiar voice hit my eardrum accompanied with the feeling of intense pressure, almost as if I were underwater. In the passenger seat of my beat-up pickup sat Ashley, just as I'd left her the morning before. Ashley? Met with the grin that burned in my memory. You know. I decided it best not to draw too much attention to myself, or the criminal on the run and suggested we talk inside, but she insisted I drive her. Where? I asked. The gas station. I agreed without probing and asked nothing. The 40-minute drive was filled with small talk and casual conversation that she seemed to delight in. Of course I was distracted by the newfound discovery of who she was, and what she'd done, but it didn't seem to faze her. We both knew that the other knew it, but it wasn't ever addressed. I didn't want to address it. When we arrived at the same station yesterday she turned to me, reluctant to leave. Can I ask you something? Of course. Do you love me? She asked with confidence once more, eyes never leaving mine. I couldn't speak. Was she crazy? Why would she keep asking me, a stranger, such a personal question with an obvious answer? I didn't know her. I didn't even know her name until last night. Her smile dropped and eyes left mine as she gently shut my passenger door and headed for the entrance. That's when I noticed she'd left her phone on the seat and decided to wait for her to come back looking for it. Perfect, I thought. She'll come back asking for it and I'll apologize. After about 20 minutes of waiting, I decided she wasn't going to come back. I grabbed her phone and walked towards the front door. I'll just give it to her, apologize, and leave. Anything beyond that is going to make this worse than it is. There was no sign of her in the gas station. The bathroom door was locked, and my knocking was met with silence on the other side. Hello. Ashley. You left your phone in my car. I wanted to apologize. Silence. Hello. More silence. I chalked it up to her probably wanting to rid herself of me and the entire situation, and slid the phone under the door. Despite my earlier promise to myself to stay away from the news, her reappearance left me needing answers. There had to have been a reason for the second trip. Maybe she turned herself in. I sat in front of the television with the anticipation boiling inside of me, waiting for 6 o'clock. I wished I had. A new development in the Ashley Marshall case, the suspect in the murder of Thomas Marshall, has led investigators to a small gas station outside of Route 70 this morning, where the suspect was found unresponsive. This morning, I dropped her off at the station at 2 p.m. My vision blurred as I learned more about the woman I'd driven that afternoon, hours after her confirmed death. She was a wonderful person, an English professor, a mentor, a charitable and caring woman who loved her students and loved her job. I now knew that she was married to a powerful man. I now knew that she was 3 months into her first pregnancy. I now knew that the note she left at the scene of his murder discussed his affair and the way that it tortured her to realize that she was not loved by anyone, as she stated. I couldn't sleep that night. How could anyone? I had no indication at all that she wasn't who she said she was, that she'd been posing as the mistress of the man she stabbed to death. I racked my memory in an attempt to find any clue that she was plotting her own death, and there was nothing. Nothing beyond her too personal question, and my reckless abandon for the notion that she just needed me to lie. To tell her yes. I wished that I would have. By morning I found myself headed back to my car. I needed to go back to the gas station. To find some sort of significance to it. To look for an answer. To apologize to Ashley. Hi, Matt. To say that I was shocked would be an understatement. Maybe it was the lack of sleep or the complete shock she left me with, but she was there. Sitting in my passenger seat, smiling up at me. I need a ride to the gas station, do you mind? I got inside, and drove without saying a word. I let her go on about the weather, her dog, her car troubles, and any other mundane things she could think of until we reached halfway to her destination. Whether she was a hallucination fueled by a lack of sleep or stress, I had to make this time count. Why did you lie to me? She stared at me, confused. I know who you are, I stammered. You were married. And you killed your husband. And you were the woman from this story when I picked you up. You were pregnant, and you had me drive you to this gas station and the police found. Matt. She stopped me, still smiling. I could tell you everything. I could walk you through my life from the beginning, reliving every painful memory and every single betrayal, and it wouldn't make a difference. Not to you, or to me. You were kind that morning. You offered me help when I needed it, and showed me the first bit of human kindness I'd felt in months. I think it would make a difference to me. I could have called the police and turned you in that first night. And you didn't. There wasn't much I could say to that. It was clear that she wasn't going to open up beyond that, and in a way she was right, it didn't matter. I knew who she was and what she'd done. What more could she tell me? You're dead, I blurted. That was the one response I figured I was actually owed. I am. If that was all she was going to give me, then it was enough. If the zombie or the ghost or whatever was seated beside me needed one last ride, then I'd give it to her. The rest of the drive was silent. She only stared out the window as I drove the same path with the same turns and the same continuous stretch of highway that followed. We pulled into the parking lot and I braced myself for the question I was sure she'd asked. I will get it right this time. I would lie because she needed it. Can I ask you? I love you. Her smile, this time, was genuine. The tears that left her two bright eyes looked human. The kiss she gave my cheek, before she left my side, was almost non-existent, grasping what little physical form it had left, but it was there. My passenger seat has been empty since. I'd like to believe that despite what she'd done, she's found herself somewhere good. Somewhere pure and warm like she was. Somewhere that's so filled with love she never has to ask,